66% of developers report spending significant time managing billing logic, pricing models, and payment integration, diverting resources from core product development. My name is Paul Nashawaty. I'm the practice lead for the AppDev practice at theCUBE Research. I'm joined today by Cosmo from Metronome. Cosmo, how you doing?
Doing well, doing well. Thanks for having me, and I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, thanks for joining. I mean, this is a great topic. It's certainly interesting in the market landscape where we see software development just exploding. Why don't you give the audience a little bit about your background and tell them a little bit about Metronome?
Cool. Yeah. So I'm Cosmo. I lead technology and engineering at Metronome. And Metronome is a company that was founded about 5 years ago. We're a Series C company that's really created to solve those problems you're talking about, where, you know, 60%, the majority of developers these days are now spending significant time thinking not just how do they build their product, but also how they have to monetize it. The kind of pricing and packaging, or how you sell your product, is becoming a core part of the product experience. And that has a lot of implications that we've seen in the market for all teams within the company, including the kind of engineering, product, and tech teams. And so Metronome is a company that is trying to solve those problems for developers and really any kind of software companies.
No, it's very cool, Cosmos, because, you know, like when we were talking in our briefing, we were realizing that, you know, the world is changing, where digital product is evolving fast and the user experience is shifting equally as fast or even faster. And what we see is the change, you know, the need and the charge for software is becoming more important as we build these new software products and these offerings as we're putting them to market. So this discussion really isn't just about the billing system, so to speak. It's more about aligning business models to applications and how they're used and what it means for developers, product teams, and the future monetization of those applications. Because I really think that that's a big part of it. So Cosmos, I want to jump right in, because I think when we look at, you know, everything that we're looking at here with regards to productization, the business model is part of the product now, right? So when we look at it, developers are increasingly influencing pricing model. It's not just financial decisions anymore. It's as companies are shifting from flat rate to usage-based models, applications teams need to architect for flexibility, right? When we're looking at that, and we also see from a market trend perspective that SaaS and AI-based native companies like Snowflake, OpenAI, and Stripe are setting new expectations for pay of what you use models, right? These are new like ways to drive this. So, you know, like when we look at this, you know, how are platforms expected to extract or abstract, you know, from complexity while enabling experimental time and experimentation, allowing for ship pricing to basically be the same way that they ship features, right? So that's a big question here.
Yeah, there's a lot going on both in the market and in the question. So let me kind of walk through how we're seeing it at Metronome, which is really, I think, in the last, you know, let's say 10, 15 years, maybe, we're seeing software markets really mature. There's a lot more players in the markets. There's a lot more companies, a lot more competition. There's a lot more maturity in the market. Like the companies have been around for a while. Software is a much more established space than it, you know, than it was even like say a decade ago, and simultaneously you see kind of zero the cost of borrowing money, the cost of raising money as a startup go up, like zero interest rate phenomenon is over. And really what this leads to kind of across the board is you have more players who are more competitive, you have more discerning buyers who care a lot more about value and price alignment. And also actually kind of a touch on that is the kind of seat model where you're charging based on how many users the buying company has. The seat model, you kind of saw lose some popularity as ZERP ended and as companies started hiring more slowly in 2015, 2018, the seed model basically was guaranteed revenue growth because companies were hiring like crazy. And then as that hiring slowed, we saw companies feel pressure to change to a model that still modeled revenue growth, even if their customers weren't hiring more people. Suddenly, companies feel immense pressure to have a business model that aligns the value that they are selling to the customers with the price that they are charging. And so that can take any number of forms for different companies. You mentioned a couple, OpenAI and Snowflake, Stripe. All three of those companies have relatively different pricing models, right? Snowflake is charging based on queries, and Stripe is charging a rake on top of your transactions, among other kind of models. OpenAI does kind of per inference or whatnot. But all of those pricing models are more directly tied to the usage of the product. And they are more complex generally. There's a lot that goes into computing, you know, Snowflake's query costs or Stripe's transactional costs or OpenAI's inference costs. And so this puts a lot of pressure on tech teams, on engineering teams. Now you not only have to ship your product, you have to ship your, you know, whatever the core functionality of your product is, but you also then have to ship complex, in a lot of cases, complex to implement and complex to understand, and even in some cases, pricing models on top of that. And so that just puts a lot of onus on the entire company, while simultaneously, the market is much more competitive. You might have, for any kind of vertical or category that you are competing in, you might have 4, 10, or 50 competitors. Every single, product category in the AWS product suite, there's now 50 startups that are all doing it, and they all have to compete on the core product as well as any sort of pricing and packaging on top of that. And so that that pressure is immense for engineering teams, like you're saying.
Yeah, Cosmo, that is absolutely spot on. And I think you touched on a couple of things I want to unpack, right? One of the things that really comes up is the table stakes. There's a lot of companies out there that are doing similar type of things, and they're all trying to like position. And what I see is, one of the factors that makes it kind of relatively important when it looks at, the costs around building out these offerings is real-time usage visibility, right? And customers are expected to know what they're using and when they want to use it and what costs what, when you're building out. So the developer burden really is about usage metering, consumption dashboards, building integration where accurate, reliable, and scalability is kind of part of the whole solution. But like when you look at that, and I think FinOps isn't just for cloud billing. And, dare I mention a term that's FinDevOps, right? Where we're entering this era of engineering and financing intersecting the user experience. I know that may be for some of the larger companies, but even some of the smaller companies, when they're doing deployments in these initiatives that they're building, they need to understand the cost factors, and it's better to understand it upfront, right? So how usage-aware design is creeping into product management and development workflows is also a key factor here. So Cosmo, when we're looking at the real-time usage of these costs and such, what are you seeing in the market? Do you think that what I mentioned here is real, or is it just like way too far out in the future?
Oh no, you were spot on. I think the only thing I would add is that, you mentioned kind of it's not just the FinOps team, it's now kind of engineering and this FinDevOps and all that. I think really as companies add more complex, more variable, more real-time pricing into their kind of product suite, it really affects the entire company. Billing is now, every team's problem. It's marketing's problem. You have to, understand how your prices relate to competitors when you might not, if your competitors are both billing by seat and you cost $8 and your competitor costs $10, that's an easy story to tell. If you're charging by outcomes and your competitors charging by inputs, that's much harder to tell a story around. It infects sales. Sales comp is a very obvious example where companies have to figure that out. When you sign a usage-based contract, the contract sort of definitionally is worth $0 initially because there's no usage before the contract was signed. So you have to then figure out how are you incentivizing your sales team to sign commits or, prepaid spend or that kind of thing. And then, you touched on it, I think all your points were exactly right, where the customer demands more, that then demands more from your tech team or from your engineering team around delivering real-time visibility in a seat or a subscription where maybe you can change mid-month and it's prorated, but really the size of the contract is not changing that much month to month. You can download a cohort CSV out of Stripe or out of your internal data system once a month and give that off to your finance team. Your users kind of have a rough understanding of how much they're spending and how many users they have because they can just see them your product on the users page or something. But if in a real time, in a usage based world where you're doing outcome or input based pricing, where your costs are fluctuating hour by hour, minute by minute, second by second as your usage changes, that your users will then pull those insights from you. Like, if you don't have some visibility of that in product, or you're not giving them visibility in like roughly as it happens, they will come to your customer support teams, and the customer billing's a customer support problem, or they'll come, you know, they'll come to your sales team and try to set, you know, like go to a competitor that has that visibility. We really see that as you start to evolve your pricing and packaging to be more complex, to be more real time, it really puts pressure on the entire org. And, you know, you mentioned, I think exactly right, the way it puts pressure on engineering is you need to now, first of all, have a way to represent these business models that are complex and harder to calculate. Seats is easy, right? It's number of seats times the price, basically, with some proration. Usage can be very difficult. And so you have to compute all that in real time, or, you know, close to real time, because any delay between usage and when you show your customer, then is a bad customer experience. You also probably need to put customer controls and spend controls in so they don't burn through their cost. They're spent, you know, like what they're expecting to spend, that kind of thing, because that's also about a customer experience. So there's a lot of aspects across the whole org, and it all kind of is predicated on having real-time visibility into that, for which your engineering teams then need to provide.
Cosmo, I want to build on that, because like there's not, you're absolutely right. There's pieces that you see that the using of the application that the end user will get, right? Which everything you kind of touched on was spot on, in my opinion. I mean, it was certainly from a analytics perspective of how the product's being used. Well, let's look at from the other side, from the software developer side. So the application development side, the usage of data is a strategic asset for product and growth. And it really, in my research, I'm seeing this taking off. So beyond billing, usage data helps with identifying popular features and power tiers, pricing, as well as potential upsells for moments, right? So you can kind of use that for your sales motions. But developers are building and instrumenting powers that have provide insights that increasingly need tools and surface value without adding additional development drag, right? So like they're looking at like, where should we build and how should we look at this? And then of course we look from a market trend perspective, as AI infused applications and platforms are proliferating across the landscape, usage variability makes a traditional billing very brittle and less predictive. And that's not something that organizations can really tolerate anymore, right? They have to have that flexibility and the fluidness of the adjusting. So like one of the things that I see from a DevOps perspective is a lot of times DevOps teams will over provision because they don't have visibility into the budget, but eventually that comes back and the organization is going, well, you know, you really have to right size this and provision it right. So we're not wasting here. You know, I guess when I think about this, Cosmo, the thought really comes down to what are forward-thinking teams doing to future-proof that monetization to flexible backends? Where are they using these types of solutions in order to like figure out like the product roadmap and the usage side and then predictability of the spec? Where does it all come together?
Yeah, that's I can take that question in a couple different directions. So I'd say the first thing is data is crucial. That's what you said. We're seeing that more and more. Every company is sort of becoming a data company, whether they like it or not. Sort of like every company is becoming a, you know, pricing and packaging company, whether they like it or not. You have, you know, if you're having a much more rich and complex pricing model, you have so much more opportunity to then leverage the data you see there, saying like, you know, per SKU rates or per, you know, revenue per, literally per API call, if you want to get that granular, and really you can tweak everything about your offering. But then you also touched on kind of the experience as a buyer, right? Like buyers are being pressured to be much more discerning and be able to explain the individual cost line items to service their products. And so you have to, again, understand how much are you paying for this product? Are we over-provisioned for it? Why are we over-provisioned for it? If we're, you know, how can we not over-provision for it while still getting the benefits of the price per value or however the product's charging? And then how can we bring that back into our bottom line when we're servicing our product? And so I think in both these cases, either as a buyer or as a seller, you need to have really granular data, as granular as possible. You would love to, ideally, like I would love to be able to instrument all my AWS costs with the individual API requests that they serve. So I can say this API request cost us, you know, X cents and we made Y cents on it. And that's our margin, and then use that data to make sure that we're building a financially solid business. But that becomes a very hard data problem. You don't want your engineers working on that. You want, ideally, you know, the tools that you're buying to have the granular cost visibility and controls so that you can feed that into your kind of analysis. And you want your internal analysis to be hopefully done on some sort of platform where you don't have to, you know, have a bunch of FinOps or FinDevOps or all the resources you're talking about work on that. Because at the end of the day, you just want to be building your product. But the fact that everyone, both selling and buying, is moving towards these more complex models means that every company sort of has to become a data platform. And that's one of the things that we are really focused on making easy at Metronome, because that's the thing that we see as the core kind of insight, is that it really is just a core data problem across the whole industry.
For sure. And that was one of the reasons why I really wanted to have you on the podcast here today, because I really think that, you know, from our discussions that we were talking about, the way software is being bought and sold is changing, and developers are really on the front lines of making those changes. But usage-based billing isn't just a financial shift, as you kind of alluded to. It's really about product and engineering consideration on affecting the broader application development trends, like velocity, transparency, and user empowerment as well. So, like, you know, when we think about this, Cosmo, as we're kind of coming to the end of the session here, and we start thinking about pricing as a feature, whether platforms are looking at custom builds, how are teams treating billing and as part of their journey as a better way to equip their compete and growth in the market space? So, like, they're looking at these different things, and how are they going to compete moving forward?
Yeah, I would say the number one thing, if you were to take one lesson away from this, is just there. Do not assume that your pricing is going to be static. It is not going to be. As you grow your business, it is, in fact, I think, going to be changing more now than it was even a year ago. It was even 4 years ago. And so whatever you're doing, whether or not you're buying a solution like Metronome to help with this, or you're building in-house on top of your own kind of data expertise or data lake or data streaming systems, you just cannot be building in assumptions that your pricing and packaging is going to remain static. You have to be able to adapt to the market. You have to be able to completely change. You know, maybe you want to switch from input-based pricing to outcome-based pricing. That's a big shift. And if you build some system early on when you're a startup or when you first spin up the billing team that can't shift 2 years later, you will become a drag on your entire organization's kind of go-to-market motion and your company's kind of growth in general. And so, you know, one way or another, you just have to make sure that billing is a lever for growth and not a headwind slowing that growth down. I think, and so having that flexibility is crucial in this market.
Cosmo, I thank you for joining me today. Your insights have been really insightful. I mean, I really think they've been awesome. And you know, it is changing, and this is an evolution. So I want to thank you for being joining me today and being my guest on this session. I want to thank the audience for tuning in, and we appreciate you being part of the AppDevANGLE community. Well, so this wraps up this episode, and we'll be back next Wednesday for another conversation diving into tools, trends, and talent shaping the future of application development, whether developing to the edge, building AI, modernizing your applications on cloud and stack. We've got you covered. So be sure to follow us on social, and if you have any thoughts, questions, or just want to connect, you can always reach out to me at paulan@siliconangle.com. Until next time, stay curious and stay built. Thank you.